Amen, amen. Hey, I'm going to jump right in the word. The good thing is that I know you'll be blessed by an anointed preacher, but also you are blessed by a short-winded preacher. And so I'm going to try to get this message out as quick as I can, because I believe that the Holy Spirit is going to do some things in this place tonight. How many came with expectation to say, I believe the Holy Spirit is going to do something in me tonight? Because expectation frames our experience. If we come expecting God to do something, it's the whole aspect of honor. Expectation in this environment is honoring the atmosphere you're about to enter. And honor is the key that unlocks the treasure. When you see a person and you honor them, it says if you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. If you receive a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, you receive a righteous man's reward. So if you honor your pastor, get this, if you honor your pastor, that is the key that unlocks the gift that your pastor is. And you say, give me an example of this. You ever notice that your pastor can say something, but yet you find some familiarity with your pastor, so maybe the honor has dropped. And he says, husbands, love your wives like Christ loves the church. You're like, all right, that's good, pastor. We're going to go to the buffet here in a minute. But then let Stephen Furtick get on Facebook and let him say, husbands, love your wives like Christ loves the church. I love Furtica. I know you're probably watching tonight and I admire your ministry. But the thing is this, it's like, because you have honor, because you don't have familiarity, you say, oh, that was revelation knowledge. What if we honored those around us more than we honor those distant from us? What if we honor the atmosphere tonight to say, God, I want to unlock the treasure of what you want to do in this place tonight? I believe expectation does that. I want to talk to you tonight about being a house of revival, being a house of revival, and what it looks like to be a house of revival. If you go to the book of Haggai chapter 2, I want to begin there and just to lay a foundation, and we'll also go over to Matthew 27 and Acts 2. And you may be thinking to yourself, where is this preacher going? This is not contextual. This is jumping. This is scriptural hopscotch. We're all over the place. And while I understand context, can we also make it a point to understand there's not only the immediate context, there's the beta context. There's that all of this is a part of God's redemptive story. This is all a part of God's word. And even though there were different people writing with pens, there's the same author named the Holy Spirit. And so when we look in the book of Haggai chapter 2, we see that Solomon's temple that had this great splendor and glory had been destroyed. And there is this temple that has been rebuilt, and this generation of people that have been raised up hearing about the greatness of Solomon's temple, the grandeur of Solomon's temple. They had all of these stories of how great and magnificent it was. But yet they find themselves at this place with what they had to replace it was somewhat not as nice. It wasn't a time of great prosperity like they had before when Solomon was king. And so there wasn't as much gold. There wasn't as much splendor. It was kind of disappointing, to be honest with you. But yet we see this word that is released in Haggai chapter 2, verse 9. It says, the glory of this latter temple shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place, somebody say, in this place, I will give peace, says the Lord of hosts. In this place, I will give peace. In this place. Right here at Generation Changer, God is going to do something. He is going to give peace where there is turmoil. He's going to give freedom where there is, in this place, he's going to do it. Can he do it in this place? Can he do it in your home? Can he do it in your job? Can he do it in your family? Can he do it in your schools? Like, he can do it. We have to have an appetite and expectation for revival. And so we see that he says he's going to do something here. He's calling his shot, so to speak. But then time begins to pass, and he says the latter glory. And you may be thinking, well, what is the latter glory? Now, this temple experienced its own destruction and its own revitalization project by Herod. And we see that as Herod does this and he rebuilds and he reestablishes, he revitalizes the temple, there was a day in which a mother took her child into this temple to be dedicated. And his name was Jesus. And the greater glory had just arrived in this temple. to house the glory in a way it never had before. And then he went back at 12 years of age and they couldn't find him, and he was being about his father's business. A greater glory had entered the temple. And then we see him turning over money tables and driving out the money changers and saying that my father's house shall be a house of prayer, and you have turned it into a den of thieves. The greater glory had entered the temple. But yet we also see that this same Jesus who entered the temple, you may think, well, that was just a visitation because he didn't stay in the temple. He didn't stay there. He ascended back to the Father. But look also what happened in Matthew chapter 27. In Matthew chapter 27, in verse number 50 and 51, it says, "And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn from top to bottom." Can you see what's happening here? That he says, "I'm going to go be with the Father, but I'm doing something in the earth." And it didn't rip the veil from bottom to top. It is not something man can do. He ripped it from top to bottom to say, "I'm removing the barrier between you and my glory." He says, "I'm going to fill the earth with my glory like the water covers the sea." We see that this sets the stage for what was about to take place at the temple, in the vicinity of the temple at Pentecost. In Acts chapter 2, which is going to be our main text tonight, Acts chapter 2, we see that the disciples have listened to what Jesus has told them to do, to go and wait and to tarry on the Holy Spirit. And he says in Acts 1, before he ascends, he says that you'll be empowered by the Holy Spirit to be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And the end of Luke's gospel, he says, "But go wait until you're endued, you're clothed with power from on high." I want you to think about this for a moment. These disciples who have seen the resurrected Christ, yet he looks at them and he says, "Don't start your mission yet. Go sit down and wait until I empower you with my spirit." A significant moment in human history as we see that Pentecost rolls around. I love that God doesn't do anything by accident. I love that when we see that Jesus was crucified at Passover and he was raised at first fruits, and he waits until he gets to the point of Pentecost to send the Holy Spirit. A powerful prophetic picture as you understand that Pentecost was the celebrating of the giving of the law. And at the giving of the law, 3,000 people were killed. But yet at the giving of the Spirit, 3,000 people were saved. How many know there's life in the Spirit where there was death in the law? And so he waits for this moment, and we see that as they're gathered there, it begins in Acts chapter 2. Beginning of verse 1, it says, "When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all in one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven." Suddenly there came a sound from heaven. Now I want you to just get this in your mind. This is a feast of Pentecost. People had pilgrimages to go to Jerusalem because of this feast. So there were people from all over the globe in Jerusalem at this time. God knew exactly what he was doing. He was waiting for the most contagious moment that he could send his spirit. It goes on to say, "And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. And there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one set upon each of them, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven." And it says, "And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. They were all amazed and marveled, saying to one another, 'Look, are not all these who speak Galileans? And how is it that we each hear in our own language, which were born Parthians and Medes, Elamites, those dwelt in Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya, joining Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes?'" Proselytes were God-fearers. "Cretans and Arabs, we hear them speaking in our own tongues, the wonderful works of God." Listen, "So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, 'Whatever could this mean?' Others mocking said," they're full of new wine. Would y'all pray with me? Jesus, I thank you for the opportunity to speak your word. I ask for your anointing tonight. I ask that you prepare our hearts to receive this tonight, God. If I say anything in my flesh, guard their hearts, Lord. But if what I say is from you, let it find good ground to bring forth a harvest in Jesus' name. And everybody says, I hate to be that preacher, Mr. Soundman. Can I get just a little more in these monitors? My ears are stopped up and I'm gonna blow my voice out if I don't have that. So We see here at Pentecost something that begins to transpire. Now, let me offer this to you as a little bit of a foundational aspect to this before we get into what a culture of revival looks like and what it looks like to be a house of revival. Now, I'm talking about the empowerment of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Now, a few misconceptions is this, is that I've heard people say you need to get the Holy Spirit. And they're talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But let me offer this to you. If you are saved, you have the Holy Spirit in your life. Like, otherwise, you are not sealed under the day of redemption. Like, the Holy Spirit is who seals you. Like, you, the Holy Spirit is in your life. So when you are saved, the Holy Spirit is in you. When you are baptized in the Spirit, you are in the Holy Spirit. And you say, well, what? That's kind of confusing. It's kind of like what Jesus said. I'm in the Father and the Father's in me. It's this relational dynamic of this immersion of oneness and becoming one with that he's asking us to do when it comes to the Holy Spirit. That he doesn't just want to come in to seal you, but he wants you to step into him so he can fill you and empower you with all that he wants to call you into. It is a divine enablement and empowerment to do what you can't do yourself. And so we see this and you say, well, what about speaking in tongues? Let me offer this to you. Three of the five times it explicitly says they spoke in tongues when they were baptized in the Spirit. The other two, it implies it when it says they saw they were baptized. How do you see someone being baptized? There was an outward manifestation of what the Holy Spirit was doing in their life. So there is a very real embracing moment of the Holy Spirit. Now, some people ask me this. They say, Pastor Jason at my church, and I love them, and they say, do I have to be baptized with the Holy Spirit to go to heaven? No, but I need to be baptized with the Holy Spirit to go to Walmart. Can somebody say amen to that? Like, it ain't about getting you to heaven, man. It's about getting through Walmart, especially with Christmas season coming up. How many need the Holy Ghost to get through traffic in Nashville? Can I get a witness in the house? So it's not about am I saved. We make everything am I saved or not saved. Everything. And can I just say that is bottom line kingdom mindset. Bottom of the barrel. Am I going to heaven or not going to heaven? What if we quit saying, what if our posture changed from instead of saying, what can I get away with and still make it to heaven, to what can I do to please the heart of my Father so much more that I just want to, I want to worship him with my life. I want to please him with my mindset. I want to worship him with my words and my attitudes and my actions. It's not about not making it to heaven. It's about, can I bless his heart with the fragrance of my life? It's a totally different mindset to me. And so when it comes to this, do I have to, like, get that out of your mind? Do I get to? Do I get to have this amazing gift? Do I get to have this incredible empowerment? Do I get to rise above my own limitations to see that God wants to do exploits through my life to bring glory to Jesus? That's what it's about. Like, it doesn't just make you, let me just say this. Baptism in the Holy Ghost don't just make you speak in tongues. It does. He does. But let me tell you what else it does. It makes you a better parent. It makes you a better spouse. He makes you better employee. You show up to work on time. You don't clock out early. You do your job. Like, you do it with excellence. Like, you rise above, because everything becomes Colossians 3:23. Whatever I do it unto the Lord. So I'm not doing it to my boss that I don't like. I'm doing it to Jesus. Like when I come to church, I ain't just worshiping because I like the song or don't like the song. I'm giving him the best worship I got because he deserves my worship. It's not about I got goosebumps. No, I got the Holy Ghost. I don't need goosebumps. Like I just want more of Jesus. Like, it changes how we live. It changes our mindset. But we also need to understand the Holy Spirit. He is a person and he's God. I don't know if you know that. Because I used to not think that way. I used to think there was God who had a son and they have this spirit thing. That's like the force. I knew it was because I saw people with the force knock people on the ground. And they would say, you will pay your tithes. I'm serious. I saw people, they'd be going, be healed in Jesus' name. And I'm like, the force is with you. So Star Wars people are like really happy right now. Where are my Star Wars people? Yeah. I see y'all. We got lightsabers too, baby. It's good. It's got a sword of the spirit. Anyway, that's a whole other thing. But it's like we have this preconceived idea. I thought there was like God and he had a son. It was kind of like, can I tell something? The Father is God. The Son is God. The Holy Spirit is God. Did you know you can talk to the Holy Spirit? You can say, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for being with me today. Thank you that you're leading me. Thank you that you're empowering me. Thank you for checking my, thank you for convicting me. Thank you for convincing me of my righteousness. Thank you for leading me in the path you want me to. Thank you for being who you are. Thank you for being present in my life. Like, wake up in the morning and say, good morning, Holy Spirit. How are we going to change the world together today? Good morning. Like, Lord, what do you want to do in my life today? And it's this amazing, dynamic adventure that we get to go on with the Holy Spirit that is so much more than this staunch Christian transactional approach that I'm kind of tired of. It's like, I said a prayer. I'm going to heaven. Like, good. But can you see heaven come to you? Can you see heaven invade this place? Can you see the prayer of Jesus get answered when he taught us to pray this way? And if Jesus taught us to pray, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, don't you believe that is revealing the expectation of his heart for our lives? So he wants that for us. And I will say this, the Holy Spirit in you gets you to heaven. You and the Holy Spirit gets heaven to earth. And miraculous moments begin to happen. And we see this in Acts. This is essential for our lives. And it's important. And you say, why is he like really going in on this right now? Because I want you to understand this is more than just a caveat or a side dish in the kingdom. This is at the forefront of our calling and mission of empowerment, to be empowered by the Holy Spirit beyond our cultural norms in Christianity, to say, I want a kingdom life that sees the kingdom expand. So when it comes down to it, what does it look like when the Holy Spirit, when we host the ghost in our church and in our lives? Like I know we just got through the Halloween. I want the Holy Spirit to haunt this house. Like what I mean by that is haunt, when you look it up, what you think, it just means to occupy. Like, I want the Holy Spirit to have holy habitation in this house, but especially in this house. That we are mobile arks of the covenant. We are carrying his presence wherever we go. And that this is the thing I believe. When it says his glory will fill the earth as the waters cover the sea, it's because there are mobile people all over the globe full of his glory that is covering the earth with his glory. That means you have a responsibility to cover Nashville and Middle Tennessee with the glory of the Lord. And you're like, man, fill Nashville with the glory. I can't even fill my house with the glory of the Lord. I can't even fill my car. Like I pastor Gateway Church in Shelbyville, but I used to have road rage issues. So I have a First Baptist sticker on the back of my car. I don't want nobody to know what church I go to. Tint my windows. I don't know who it is. They said, my God, those First Baptist people are evil on the road. Just pray for them. They're Baptists. Help them, Jesus. So it don't matter. They're still saved. Always saved, right? But we're going to see some things that unpack when it comes to the culture of revival in the church. What is it like? The first thing I want to highlight to you is notice what happens in verse 2 of Acts 2. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven. It's when there is a house that is willing to host the glory and the presence of God, the Holy Spirit in a tangible way, it will always start to sound like heaven. Always will start to sound like heaven. And Pastor was telling me and enlightened me, and I don't know the Greek word. He said, what was the Greek word, Pastor? It was echos, that's it. As the word for sound there is echos. Literally, it's a word that means echo. It's where we get the word from. So literally, the sound doesn't originate in earth. It originates in heaven, and we echo Jesus even said, I only do what I see my Father doing. In other words, he wasn't living reacting to the world. He was responding to heaven. And so when we house and we host the glory, when we become a place of revival, it will start to sound like heaven. Notice what they begin to speak. They begin to speak in other tongues, but they also begin to speak the wondrous works of God. And it says they also prayed and they began to encourage. Like, well, let me just say this. One scholar I was reading said this, says that they believe that when they began to speak the wondrous works of God, it was not declaring what had already happened. It was prophesying what was about to take place. And I believe there's something that happens when we open our mouth empowered by the Holy Spirit that sounds like heaven, that in a situation we find ourselves in, when somebody comes with a bad report, I will weep with those that weep, but there's something that rises up on the inside of me that says, I am not accepting this report because I believe the report of the Lord, and he is a healer, and he is present, and he is powerful. You can't help but say something because it's like Jeremiah with fire in your bones. There's the sound of heaven. Let me say this. The sound of heaven sounds like worship. It sounds like praise. It sounds like prophetic words flowing in the house of God and in your life and outside the house of God. It sounds like edification. It sounds like encouragement. You ever thought about this? If you have a positive thought about someone, say it. Like, it doesn't bless them unless you release it. And even when you look, the word encouragement is parakaleo in the Greek. It means to call out and alongside. And as we encourage each other, we literally speak into the purpose and the destiny inside that person, and we call it out to the surface and alongside us in mission. So I can think back. I can think back to middle school. I can think back to some of the greatest compliments I ever got. I remember when I was in middle school, I loved playing basketball, and the middle school coach came up to me in front of everybody. He goes, "You have the most pure shot I've ever seen." He says, "You're not going to miss many shots." He said, "That is the best form I've ever seen." Well, guess what? At that point, I thought I was Jordan. And I was like, "I need to start, coach. I know I'm in seventh grade, but I believe I can take the eighth grade team to the championship. I have the purest shot ever." And I went on, middle school, high school, I was a shooter. I could shoot lots out because one encouraging word got me to believe in myself. It called a gift that was in there to the surface. And let me ask this, how many people around you, do you see gifts that are in them, but they don't even know it's there? And all it would take is you to say, "Hey, I notice you're super kind and very compassionate. You're a very welcoming person. You have the gift of hospitality. And I just want to say that over you." Like, what if you look at someone and said, "Hey, I heard you singing, standing by me. Like, I just want you to know you have a really gifted voice." And it doesn't mean you need to go to the worship team. It doesn't mean that you're called to it. It doesn't mean you're called to be a worship leader. Go through the tryouts. If they tell you you're not good enough, it doesn't mean you're not good enough. Just know it's not a fit here and it's not for the culture here. God bless you. I had to preface that. You're welcome, Pastor. Because I know somebody prophesies over somebody. You're gifted as a worship leader. They want to be up on the stage next week. And if we don't do it, we're not hearing from the Lord. And so there you go. But just looking at someone and saying, "I see value in you." And caught up. Let me tell you what the culture of heaven doesn't sound like. It doesn't sound like gossip. It doesn't sound like criticism. Okay, let me just say this. If there's something in this church, I know there's probably not anything because this is like a great church. If there's something in this church that you don't like, help change it. Like maybe you see it because God's revealing it to you because he wants you to be a part of the solution. He's not revealing it to you so you can armchair quarterback that thing and talk to people and complain about it. He's showing it to you so you can help make a pot. Go to your pastor and say, "Pastor, hey, I noticed we didn't have enough greeters. Can I get out there and help? I want to do something about it. Hey, Pastor, I understand the church was a little messy, and can I come in and clean on Saturday night? Hey, Pastor, like, I know we've got some sound issues. Can I help raise some money to get some better equipment? Hey, Pastor," like what? Like, he is showing you because he wants you to be a part of the solution. It's not criticism. It don't sound like heaven. It doesn't sound like whining and complaining. It doesn't sound like heaven. It sounds like worship and edification and exhortation. That is the sound of heaven. That's the first thing. We'll sound like heaven. The second thing, and I don't know where the clock is, so y'all just bear with me tonight. I said short-winded, but my God, I may need the Lord to resurrect all of us by the night. The end. The second thing, miracles will start manifesting. Can I just say, I don't want to have to apologize because I believe in miracles. Like we live in a day where it's really sexy to be depressed. Like, people get a real high out of being really low. And victimization has taken precedence over victory. And we would rather label ourselves by our issues than walk in the victory that Jesus has laid his life down for. And you say, oh, you don't understand, you're not empathetic. I'm empathetic. I understand. I will walk through it with you. I will cry with you. But at some point, you got to say, I serve a miracle working God who did not go to a cross, who did not get up on the third day to leave me in the mess he found me, but he wants to bring me out into what he's calling me into. Miracles start happening. Like he is a miracle maker. It started happening in Acts. People get healed. And on the way to the gate called Beautiful, they see this lame man. And this was their moment to say, Jesus is gone. This is my moment to say, do we really actually believe what he taught us to do and anointed us to do? And they look and say, silver and gold have I none. Such I have. Rise up and walk in the name of Jesus. He got up and walked. I heard one scholar say this, one preacher. He said, the church cannot say silver and gold we have no more. The church has been blessed, but neither can we say rise up and walk anymore. Like what if we started having the expectation, the miraculous? Now again, we have extremes that go to the unhealthy side and people start chasing miracles. That's not what I'm talking about. Like, listen, let's bring a mature, healthy approach to being filled and baptized with the Holy Spirit. Like, it is not about sensationalism. It is not about getting your fix. It is not about getting a euphoric high. It is not about, listen, some of the most amazing moments. I remember this young man came up and he asked me to pray with him, and his feet all the way up to his knees were full of blisters and the skin was peeling off. And he asked me to pray for him. And I was like, God, I ain't laying hands on that. I ain't doing it. I ain't touching it. You touch the, I ain't you, Jesus. I ain't you. Lord, you said, but speak the word. That's the greatest faith. I'm going to do that, Lord. I'm going to do that faith. And so I'm standing there, and to be honest with you, man, I didn't feel like I had enough power to blow the fuzz off a peach. Like, I said, oh, God, help him. Jesus' name. God bless you, buddy. I wish I would have told you I had one of those prayers that was like, oh, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you are Jehovah Rapha. I didn't have that prayer. The prayer literally said, Jesus, help him. All right, buddy, God bless you. He goes back to the back. He's sitting there. He starts screaming. I'm like, God, I done killed him. What did I do? He's screaming in the back of the room. And his mom's back there, and she's like, he's healed. He's healed. They brought him up, and his toenails were even about to fall off. It was so bad. And they brought him up, pulled the sock. His feet were perfectly fine. Everything, no blisters. Everything went away. And the first thing I said is, I can't believe it. First thing I was like, I can't believe it. As if the eloquence of my prayer was what was going to make the difference. That boy got healed with a preacher without an ounce of faith. Go and help him, Jesus. Like, God is a miracle maker. He can do amazing things. And listen, we need to have faith. We need to believe. But can I just say, there are sovereign moments when he breaks into space and time and says, watch what I'm about to do in your midst. How many are believing for one of those nights tonight that he's going to break in and do what only he can do? But again, don't get in the extremes of like, you know, chasing. Listen, let me just say this. Oh, there's so much, Pastor. I'm trying to like condense this. There's so many. Don't chase people. You don't have to chase people. You don't have to go to cities and say that's where revival is. I understand we can appreciate and honor what God is doing somewhere. But can I tell you, the same God that was in Brownsville, the same God that was in Lakeland, the same God that was in Toronto, the same one that was in Jerusalem, is the same God in Nashville, and he can do here if he can just find some hungry people to say, I want more of you, Lord. Because this is what I found. I don't chase signs, they chase me. It says signs will follow them that believe. I chase Jesus, and I look back and I see a trail of miracles where the Lord has done exploits in and through my life. How many's thankful he doesn't leave us alone, but he's a miracle worker God. So miracles, this should be a house of miracles. The third thing that we see is that all types of people start getting saved. All types of people start getting saved. People you don't like start getting saved. People you don't connect with start getting saved. And I can tell you, when I saw revival hit our church, when I got to our church, it was all people that were the same color, that were the same age level, and that were about the same economic, social class of people. and the same income level. It was all like-minded people. It was about 40 of them. And what we saw is the Lord grow us to 1,400 of different colors, different backgrounds, different ages. And what I found out was this, is when revival starts happening, your church will start looking different, because if it doesn't, it is not, and again, demographics, if you live in a city where there's only one, I understand that. But if it is kingdom, it will look like heaven. In Acts 2, there were people from all nations in that place. Every single one of them got to hear the gospel. People getting saved left and right. So get this, if it is the kingdom, look around and your church will start looking diverse. Not for the sake of diversity, but because it is a reflection of the kingdom of God. If you look around and all you see is like-minded people from the same background, same story, same testimony, same age level, same skin color, same cultural background, then you'll start finding out maybe we're not a kingdom expression. Maybe we are a social club expression of like-minded people who enjoy doing life together. Like the Lord is calling us. There's people in my church that were saved out of being good old boys and they weren't saved, that Jesus saved. There were people in my church that were as heathen can come, and Jesus, there were prostitutes and there were businessmen and businesswomen, entrepreneurs, different people from different backgrounds. When I look out and I see heaven, I say, yes, Jesus, do what only you can do. But to do that, it has to be a kingdom message with a kingdom people with a kingdom experience to see Jesus glorified. So understand, there's going to be different kind of people coming in. 3,000 people got saved. 3,000 people got saved. Can you imagine the follow-up calls the next day? Can you imagine Peter having to write those handwritten cards so that they could assimilate them into next steps? Like, they got saved, man. And it was this beautiful thing of people from different backgrounds coming together, rallying around Jesus and the gospel that saved them. And that's what we should be like. We should be a house where everybody can come in, where people that are gay and straight can come in, and people that are transgender can come in. But guess what? God doesn't leave us like he finds us. He delivers us. He saves us. And so understanding that, all kind of people are going to get saved. But we'll get to this fourth one. And this is where it starts getting fun. Is people are going to react differently when revival shows up. They're going to act different. Notice that there was those that, it says they were amazed, they were perplexed, but then they were mockers. People are going to react different. And let me just say this, it's okay to ask questions. Like it asks, the question, those that were amazed and perplexed, it says this, whatever could this mean? They ask a question. It wasn't a bad thing. You should ask, you should be a discerning community to say, Lord, what does this mean? Because there's moments that God has broken into our services at Gateway, and I'm like, God, that was so you. Thank you for it. And there's been other moments I'm like, was that you? Were you in that, Lord? I don't know if you are. Is that you? Like, I think it was you, but I don't know if it was you, because it kind of felt like flesh. But was that you? And if we're not careful, and this is where I think the whole message of the Spirit is, like, we take them being drunk and we think that's an excuse for us to act purely crazy. And to just, and what happens, and hear me out, I grew up Pentecostal, we jumped pews, we ran the top of pews. I mean, I had a good time, all right? And I'll be honest, the people running the pews, I don't even think they were saved, because they go out in the parking lot, smoke a cigarette, and cuss each other out. I mean, it was the weirdest thing, man. I was never afraid of unknown tongues. I was afraid of the known tongues, because they knew how to cuss really good. And so it was like, you know, what was that Jesus? Or did we work ourselves up into a frenzy? And we have accepted a placebo and a pseudo encounter, because the enemy is fine with us jumping chairs as long as we don't humble our hearts. Listen, he's fine. You can roll on this floor from one side to another, but if you get up and you're twice the devil you were before you went to the floor, he don't care if you rolled on the floor. No. That being said, there's times I have had plenty of carpet time and I went down one way and I got up another, praise the Lord. And we need that. But what I'm saying is, don't just look for manifestations, look for the master. And if you look for the master, real manifestations will show up. But people are going to respond different. People are going to roll their eyes. I've seen people get healed in services and religious people get mad. And I'm, excuse me? Like, I feel like that was showmanship. Because the dude couldn't see out of his eye, and now he can see out of his eye, and we're celebrating this dude that was blind can see. Well, you didn't have to taunt it like that. God, can I just hit one person one time? Just once. Just once. Give me a pass, please. Grace abounds much more. But it's like people respond different. So get this. Things are going to start happening here that maybe don't fit in your tradition. But we've got to be careful because the traditions of men make the word of God of no effect. So what I'm saying is when God starts doing things, you ever notice it's signs and wonders? And it's called wonders because it makes you wonder. Like, I wonder, was that God? I wonder what that means. I wonder what just happened. Like, it's wonders. And when he starts showing up, he can't help but do exploits because he is a miraculous, marvelous God that wants to encounter us in a way that marks us for the rest of our lives. All that said, landing this on this last point that I believe is, in my heart, the most important. Verse 39 goes on to say that this promise is for your children and for their children as far and as many as far off as the Lord will call. Can I just tell you what that means? Let me tell you what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean this is for a select group of people in the first century known as the apostles. And once they die, and the canonization of scripture has come into being in the fourth century because of Constantine's work and diligence in the Council of Nicaea, then we will be able to see that then the Holy Spirit is no longer needed. He can go back to heaven and wait it out until Jesus comes. Little bit of sass there. I'm sorry. That was flesh. It's for your children. And for their children, like where do we get? It's nowhere in the word that it's just for them. That is a lie from the devil. He doesn't want you empowered because you defeat him. It's for your children. For their children. Can I tell you this? I heard one church historian, he talked about the tent, the temple, and the tomb generations. And he said the 10th generation, when looking at the Spirit-filled movement, was the early people that were baptized in the Holy Spirit as the renewal came at the turn of the 20th century. And it says that they didn't have a lot. They were other side of the track kind of people. They didn't have a lot of education. They didn't have a lot of money. They were in the foothills of Appalachia. It was a poor, one-eyed black man in Azusa Street in California. It was in Kansas, in Topeka, Kansas. It was these ostracized. This was the down and outers. It was those that were mocked and ridiculed, and even their gatherings, they were persecuted. And while they didn't have respect and they didn't have prestige and they maybe didn't have nice buildings or great educational institutions, oh, the glory was in their midst. The glory was there. But then the tent generation gives way to the temple generation. The tent generation both saw and encountered the glory. The temple generation is when we begin to make our way into mainstream. And we got that dangerous thing called respect. Because once you get respect, it can become intoxicating. And once you get people respecting you, then all of a sudden you'll start laying down your values to keep their respect. We became people pleasers, trying to accommodate. And it says, these historians said that we began to build our buildings and build our education institutions. And nothing wrong with those. They're great. I mean, we bought a Walmart. Thank God. You know, like, praise the Lord. Give me more, Jesus. But it was like this generation, they saw there was a mental ascent, but they had not experienced for themselves. And they say that it gives way to a tomb generation. That has neither seen nor experienced. And I think about in Judges when they said, where are the miracles of our fathers? Like, I need us to understand there's a generation coming up. We owe them a move of God. We owe them our hunger for Jesus. We owe them our fasting and prayer, and we owe them our pursuit of His face. To mark them the same way we've been marked. People ask me, like, wow, can you ever go? I can't go back. Why? Because I know He's healer because He's healed me. I know He's spirit baptizer because He baptized me. I know He's Savior because I have encountered Him. If we have just really good production and we have really good talks, if we polish it up and we do everything with excellence, but there's no encounter, a generation will see this is no different than Peter Pan. This is no different than fairy tales. What is the difference between this religion and other religions? They don't just need the stories. They need an encounter with God, and we owe them an encounter with God. So I'm going to end this with this. I'm going to ask this question, and we're going to have a time to put our pursuit where we claim our priorities are. So let me ask you this. I said it's okay to ask questions, so I'm going to pose. I really feel led to ask this question. Would you go ahead and stand? I want to ask this question tonight. If the Holy Spirit is the gift of the Father, and it was the prescribed preparation for missional effectiveness by Jesus, why do we act like it's not that important? Like, track with me. Why do we? Because we're so afraid. And let me just say this, understandably so, because when I grew up in church, we abused the doctrine of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And we made it to where there was real Christians and then there was junior Christians. It was like, you're a real Christian if you got your prayer language. If you got your prayer language, you're good. If you're not, well, bless their heart, you know. We even wouldn't let people serve that hadn't been baptized in the Holy Spirit. I got people in my church now that serve in the parking lot. I don't even know if they're saved. But we're giving them somewhere to belong and believe that their belief is going to catch up with their belonging. No, they ain't teaching classes, don't get me wrong. I got Joe. He's a heroin addict. Doesn't believe in Jesus, but he's doing next Sunday. Y'all should come listen to him. We're not doing that. Not doing that. But you give people a place to belong. But because of that abuse, I feel like some of us, we care. I feel like we care more about people's self-esteem than we do their empowerment. And so we act like it's good. You don't really need, you don't have to. You do. Listen, if no one says you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit with power from on high, you need it. You need it, and you are called to it. You are called to it. Get this. Last thing. Being baptized in the Holy Spirit doesn't make me better than you. It makes me a better me. It makes me better than what I was. It changed my heart and my affection. I was terrified. I could not speak in front of people. I was terrified to even talk to anybody about Jesus. When I got baptized with the Holy Spirit, I could not shut up about Jesus. You say, well, give me another proof of that. Acts 4, they were terrified, being oppressed, persecuted. It says, and they prayed. They prayed. And when they prayed, it says, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. The place they were gathered was shaken. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. And it says, they spoke the word of God with boldness. I believe that God is anointing a people in such a time as this to be empowered and to be emboldened to speak the word of the Lord. And you can't do it in your own strength. So I want to ask this. I'm not going to milk this. I'm not going to beg you. If you are hungry, I'm going to pray. And when I say amen, if you would just make your way to this altar, if you say, I want to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. I want to be empowered by the Holy Spirit. I want more. I want to encounter God. I don't just want to hear about, I want to know Him. When I say amen, come. If you don't come, that's between you and the Lord. If you don't want it, that's between you and the Lord. But the invitation is given. The opportunity is here. And the promise of the Father is for you. So let's pray. Jesus, I thank you for who you are. I thank you that you are Savior, that you are sanctifier, that you are spirit baptizer, that you are healer, and you are soon coming King. I believe that you're in this place to not do what only you can do in this place. Fill us, baptize us with fire of the precious Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name I pray, and everybody says, amen. Amen. I'm asking the prayer team to join me here. If you're hungry and say, I want more, join me in this altar tonight.